or there will be trouble.
Of course, machines can't think as people do. A machine is different.
And thank you, Amanda. So, this is the science part of the science and film, and I'm going to talk about the physics of vision here today. And here are my topics, actually. In fact, I'm going to start with what I call seeing and believing, because I want to emphasize a few things about perception. But then I'm going to tell you about the eye as an instrument. And in particular, and very important for tonight's theme, is something about how we see color. So, it seems fitting that a beautiful picture like this, either because winter has finally come and we don't know how long it will last, but we can look forward to spring, or of course because of Vermeer being Dutch, that we're looking at a scene here of tulips. And what I want to have you think about, and maybe even help me think about here, is the following. So what our eyes and the entire process of seeing, our eyes and brain can do for us, is many things. And we have evolved, of course, to have these capabilities very much because that's how we've survived and as a species. And one of the things that we can do that not many other species can do is see color. But what I'd like you to think about, and I'm going to see if it's even possible with this crowd to get some answers from you, is this question. What are some of the ways that we can see? And what I mean by that is if you look at an object or you look at a scene or you look at something, what does seeing help you do? What do you see? What are some of the aspects or features of what you're looking at that your eyes and brain help you? Now, I can't see you because the lights are so bright, but they're going down just a little bit. But does anybody understand this question? Okay? Does anybody have an answer? One of the things that we see, yes? Okay, perhaps how far away it is? Okay, that's one thing, certainly. Very good. Another one?
Texture.
Sorry?
Texture?
Texture, yes. So, texture of an object, or maybe we could call it, you know, changes in color or changes in brightness. We might call that contrast. I like to call that contrast. I have my own terms. Another one? Motion, yes, motion. That's exact. It's very important to be able to detect motion if you're worried about a mountain lion jumping on you or something like that, certainly. I heard another one, but I didn't catch it.
Shape,
the shape of objects, yes, that's very important. Anything else?
Light
or brightness of an object, sure. Or a scene or the things that we're looking at, or changes in brightness, somewhat related to contrast.
Chroma,
was that color?
Color?
Yeah, the density of color, so aspects of color. Okay, very good. Anything else anybody want to add?
Perspective.
Pardon me?
Perspective.
Perspective, right. And perhaps that's related to where we are in relation to something. And I think maybe I'll add, related to perspective is how far away things are, right? We're able to do that. In fact, two eyes help us do that quite a lot, and you've probably all experienced, I know it's after the movie, but when you had your popcorn and the lights were up, if you closed one eye and tried to reach in to get a piece of popcorn, it's a lot harder than you have if you have two eyes, because we're making some combination of moving our hand and adjusting how far we think we are from the piece of popcorn or whatever the food is. So here's my list, size and shape, we got that. Distance, perspective, or depth of field, many different answers. The brightness of objects. Our eyes can do all this, and of course see color in many different ways, contrast, and motion. So I think we all agree. Now, There's science to being able to do all of these things, but we also think about it. We interpret what we see. In fact, this scene that you see here is a photograph. It's two-dimensional, but I'll bet you can tell me which tulips are further away and which tulips are closer. Where are the closer tulips? Okay, they're in the foreground of this picture. How do you know that? They're bigger, right? We expect that things that are closer to us are bigger. And of course, the upper parts of this, there's a little red pointer here that's really hard to see, but the upper parts of this, the tulips are further away. So we just kind of expect that things that are further away are smaller because we kind of know how big a tulip is. Or at least we know the difference between a tulip up close, which looks bigger, and a tulip that's farther away. But the tulips aren't bigger further away, are they? They're all the same size. You're interpreting this. Now, also the foreground is closer, right? And the bottom part of the picture is closer, but that's not always true. Let's take a look at this. This is the same scene, but now we backed up from it. And what's in the distance? Okay, the middle part of this is in the distance. What about those clouds? You can tell which clouds are closer and which are further away, right? The clouds that are closer are at the top of the picture, and the clouds that are further away are off near the horizon. Okay, so I'm emphasizing this because this picture, we get a lot out of it. We can understand this picture, even though we're not using the normal way that we can tell distance, we're thinking about it. And that's a form of perception that's part of vision. Now, this is near, this is far, and this is near again. So keep this in mind. Again, I'll come back to this picture, and what I'm gonna show you a little bit later is the top part of the picture where the clouds are bigger because they're closer, and the clouds near the horizon are further away. So let's take a look at this, okay? I've often been asked and tried to explain, and it's actually not very much a physics or science question, why it is that the moon looks so large, I'm sorry, I didn't say it right, why is it that the moon is so large when it's just rising, for example, or near the horizon? And, well, let's see if we can understand that. So, first of all, the moon is not changing size, and is not even changing apparent size. The apparent size of the moon is best expressed as an angle. And that angle is just about half a degree in the sky. The moon does get closer and further away from the Earth. It goes from about 357,000 to 406,000 kilometers, and the moon is about 3,500 kilometers apart. So if you do the math, you can get the angle, and when the moon is closest, that angle is 0.56 degrees, just over half a degree, and when it's close, it's just under half a degree. So this apparent size of the moon, it does get bigger and smaller, but by a very small amount compared to what we perceive when we see the moon rising at the horizon. So it's about half a degree in the sky. It doesn't matter whether it is rising or high up in the sky. So I say it's always about half a degree. But it seems so big near the horizon. So let's look at the top part of my picture that I showed you. So the tulip field has fallen off the bottom here. So here's a cloud that's above us, and it's big. In fact, there, right? It's a big cloud. But the clouds here on the horizon take up a much smaller part of our field of view, a smaller angle, all right? Now, normally, actually, let's make it dark, okay? Can you still see the clouds? Yeah, so it's nighttime now. There's the moon up in the sky as we expect to see it. Looks fine, all right? And the moon near the horizon, because those clouds seem so much smaller than the moon, but when the moon is up there, it's small compared to the clouds. That is why we perceive the moon to be so large when it rises. So there's that. And that's just blown up. Looks pretty big, doesn't it? To emphasize that the two are the same size, you don't ever see this in real life, at least on our planet. That gives you an idea of how our thinking gets involved and even fools us. Now, we discussed the things that vision do for us, and among those are contrast. It's very important to be able to discern contrast. In fact, we're so ready and wired for contrast that that sometimes we see it when it's not there. So let's take a look at the middle bar here. What do you see? Is it uniform? Is it brighter on the left, brighter on the right? The one in the middle? Okay, it's brighter over here, you think? And darker over here. Anybody disagree? Okay, I'm asking you how it appears. How does it seem to you? All right. Do you still disagree? All right, anyway, it's really uniform in brightness, but because we're comparing it to bars on the top and bottom that are changing in brightness, essentially brightness, we want to see that contrast. And many optical illusions work this way. Here's just a set of them that we like to remind ourselves of. I have to say, I don't want to fall off the stage, but you have to be a little ways away. So I think that you can probably see these better than I do, but they're sort of classics. This one, the question certainly is these line segments in the middle, which is longer, and of course, they're the same. Oh, you guys are done these before. These lines are straight, not curved, but they look curved because we're seeing them, comparing them, right? It's a comparative thing, comparing them to curved lines. The white circle in the middle of these two is the same size. This isn't an intelligence test. This is a question of what we see. Now, this says something moving. Do you see white spots in here? Yeah? And dark spots in here? Okay, this has to do partly with the way we perceive light and dark, and it's comparative, as was noted in the movie. But the point I want to make here is that it's not hard to see things the way they aren't. All right. So let's go move on to talk about the eye. This is a picture of the eye that I use for when I teach classes, and there's, you know, it's not really very anatomically wonderful or accurate, but it does have several important elements. But the most important things that I'm going to talk about here today, as the eye as an instrument, are the front surface here, which is the cornea, and it's curved, and a piece of the eye in here, which is called the lens, and it is controlled by some muscles that can actually change the shape of that lens a little bit and therefore change its focusing power. So what happens when light enters the eye is that it's focused by mostly, really dominantly, by the fact that there is a boundary between air and the material of the eye, which is very much like water from an optical point of view, and a little bit extra focusing from this lens. And the job of this, of course, is to cause an object here. So here's a tulip that's showing up pretty well, colored tulip. And the tulip looks the way it does because to us, because there's some light coming in, reflecting off of the tulip, and that light comes into the eye. Now, what the technical term, not surprisingly, is image, okay? And this optical system of our eye actually forms an image. So what an image is it's the convergence of what we call rays of light, there's one, from a specific spot on an object, so the tulip is the object, and when it enters the focusing of the eye, it gets bent a little bit, and to a point on the screen, which in the case of your eye is the retina. And there's another one from the same point to the same point. So it's one point on the object to one point on what will be the image is what we call focusing, and there's a third example here. And from the bottom of the tulip, there's also a set of these, and that forms on our retina an image. And notice that the yellow part of the image is down, so it's an inverted image. You may know that. And then our brain does the job of processing that and telling us that it's right side up. Another thing about this image is that it's actually pretty small, right? Now, one of the interesting things is if I raise my hand up about like this, from the floor to the top of my hand is about 2 meters. And in the middle of the house is about 25 meters away from me. And the size of the image of me on your retina is about 2 millimeters. Okay, so it's pretty small, and then that gets processed. So the eye can focus near. That's what this example is. This is something within maybe about 25 centimeters is this kind of official point that we call near. And then something far away, very far away, like the moon. Also. So the eye also has the ability to make things that are fairly close to us appear clear, focus and make an image on our retina. And by changing the shape of this lens here, the eye can focus on very distant objects as well. Now, on the retina, we have photoreceptive cells that are called rods and cones, and there are chemicals, different kinds of opsins. I'll tell you a little bit more about those. And these really allow us to record the brightness, the color, the shape of the image on the retina, and the size of the image on the retina. So this is a picture of the retina. The light actually comes in this picture from the bottom. What we see here are things called rods and cones. And you understand now why they have those names, right? These are kind of cone-like things, and these are rod-like things. There are about 6 million cones. Those are used for color vision, and about 120 million rods in our eye. And they're distributed differently across the retina. Now, this is a rather technical picture here, but there's an important point that I want to make without going through it in great detail, and that is that there are chemicals that are sensitive to the light. And the way this happens is that energy is absorbed. In a moment, I'll tell you a little more about the packets of energy that are absorbed in light. They're called photons. But energy is absorbed, and in so doing, a certain chemical changes shape. That chemical is called retinol. And that is connected to the opsin. In the rods, it's called rhodopsin or rhodopsin. And this thing changes shape, and when it does, you know, you sort of use the molecule. Now, it will go back to its original shape. That's the meaning of this. But once you've used it, it takes a little while for it to come back. And so there's a kind of remarkable things that arise from that. So what I'd like you to do is stare at this for about 15 seconds at the start. Now, what's happening is the image of the star is, in some sense, being burned onto your retina. And the image of that star is a little over a millimeter on your retina. And as it is doing that, the chemicals are changing their shape, and it takes a while for them to come back. So you're sort of burning out a part of the retina. And so when I go to this, now I believe that what you're seeing is sort of grayish, right? You know, what we've basically done is taken out the white, and if you take out the white, you get a grayscale thing. So that gives you an idea of how this process works. And was it moving at all for you? Well, it's not moving, guys. In fact, it's not even there. but that's the way vision works. Now let's talk about color. Vision, the cones are involved in color vision, and there are actually three different kinds of chemicals, and what's different about them is that they're sensitive to different colors of light. Now, we call them blue, green, and red. The rods are the rhodopsin, or the dotted one in the middle, blue, green, and red. But what is shown here along the bottom axis of this graph is what we call the wavelength of light in units of nanometers, so we've worked the word nano in today. But also important from this is that what we see when the light is on the small end of this, 400 and so, is what we call violet or blue. And over on the other side, around 700, we call that red. And there's various ways that we can perceive the colors in between. So we have three different kinds of cones, three different colors of cones. Some see in this blue range. Notice they overlap. Some see in the red range, and the green is kind of in the middle. Now, the way that this works is that the light itself comes into the eye. In fact, all light comes into the eye in discrete, what we call discrete packets of energy. A certain amount of energy is flowing into the eye in quantum discrete packets, which we call photons. And bluish photons have more energy. And so if the molecule needs more energy to have its shape changed, then it needs a blue photon. And that is one particular chemical that's in the blue cones. And green is less than blue, but more than red, and red is the least. And so it's actually the energy of these photons that is the reason that we can, that there can be three different chemicals that distinguish red, green, and blue. So to finish up here, what I'm going to do is a similar kind of exercise. I'm going to make you stare at the stars. Now, you're going to look at this. You stare, I'll talk. This is blue. We have blue cones. And just like the white star, what you're doing is removing the sensitivity to blue in that star shape on your retina. And if you take blue away, you're left with red and green. And you put red and green together, and what do you see? And that one I don't think is moving as much, right? It is. Okay, cool. All right, let's see. So let's just do the whole thing. This is green. All right, stare. If green is being taken away, we're left with blue and red. All right. And actually, what do blue and red make? They make purple, but there's a slightly more official name that the printers use for that. And when you go to buy ink for your inkjet printer, this is actually the color, which is purplish, yeah, magenta. And then finally, red, we're left with green and blue and ready? Cyan. Okay. So did that work? I gave you enough time. All right. Anyway, that's it. After all the science part, after the eye acts as an instrument, the brain takes over. And that's what we discussed at the beginning about some of the things that we perceive. So in addition, Professor Celeste Brasati is now going to take over and talk to you more. She's a professor of the history of art, of course, and will talk to you more about Vermeer. Thanks.
I love that cue, the brain takes over. That's me. let me give you something to look at. All right. Thank you. Whoa. The really challenging part of this lecture is that I'm told I must stand in this pool of light. And there are two bright, bright lights that are staring at me. So you'll bear with me as I accommodate to that. Well, here we are. Some thoughts about Vermeer and indeed Tim's Vermeer. So did he paint a Vermeer? Does Tim's Vermeer look like a Vermeer? Well, yes and no. And what I want to do in this next little bit is think about some of the ways that their projects converge and differ. And when Tim tells us, you know, I sort of identify with Vermeer, I can imagine him being a kind of tinkerer and basically a guy just like me. And there's something to it, but also the one big difference is, as Tim tells us many times in the film, he's not a painter. But guess what? Vermeer is. And that matters a lot because, contrary to the inference, there are a lot of massaged facts in the film, and that's good, it makes for a better story. Vermeer did not spring out of nowhere. We do not have a document telling us who trained him, but we know for sure that he was trained as a painter because he was admitted as a master into the guild, and in order to be admitted, you had to submit masterpieces, something like these two early works of Vermeer that may be very, very different from what you think of when you hear that name. Right, we have a view of Vermeer based on about 30-some works that he did over the course of 20 years. He died a young man, he was 43, and he worked through from this set of skills that he learned in the traditional way, skills of seeing, skills of applying paint in layers, skills that require, you know, habituation of the body. All the things that Tim did not bring to his project. So the question is, how does Vermeer get from there to there? And what you're looking at in this early mythological scene of Diana and her companions is the kind of painting that gets relegated to the wall in Vermeer's later works, such as this woman writing a letter with her maid. And so he turns his gaze, he turns his lens. I'm not going to say that Vermeer did not use optics. I think he did. But how he used them is, I think, somewhat different from the impression you might get from Tim's saga. Light is something that has a life of its own in Vermeer's work. You can see him doing all sorts of things to show dramatic effects in the play and behavior of light. If you look at the white wall, thinking about how we see things relatively, behind the letter-writing woman, it turns from a sort of grayish white to the darkest, darkest of browns, right? It's unbelievable what's happening with that white wall. And it's also unbelievable what's happening when light plays off of those fabrics. It actually doesn't describe the fabrics, but something else, some set of abstract patterns, a little map of tones that has an independent existence from what we know about the materials that are being depicted. Now, I put that next to a painting that we have close by in Detroit by Ter Borch, who was a contemporary of Vermeer and much more typical in his approach to painting. These artists were incredibly skillful in describing and differentiating all kinds of surfaces and textures, and they were describers. And they worked very hard to make the means by which they described in paint, their facture, we call it, the mode of handling and applying paint, match very closely, seamlessly, in fact, with the things they were describing. So you look at those Ter Borch skirts and you go, oh my God, paint, satin, which is it? You know it's a painting, but it makes you do that because the fit is so tight. That fit is what Vermeer tears apart. Look at that. Look at the the puff sleeves and the cap of the woman. And not only that, look at the woman's face itself. What we know about the anatomy of that face and what we see Vermeer doing with it are two very, very different things. So there's something about light. It's wild, it's crazy in Vermeer, and it is not about transcribing reality, but something else is happening. The artifice of optics is what interests him. So thinking back to what I said earlier about Vermeer having been trained as a painter, some of the things that he would, and this is one of his great demonstration pieces, a piece that his wife kept and wanted not to have auctioned after his death to pay their debts, a wonderful picture of the art of painting, painting in the process of being made. And here he's shown us a muse, actually a model dressed up as a muse of history in front of a wonderful map. But he's at work, or an artist, anonymous, is at work. And you see on the canvas that he's working up from drawing. I'll give you a bigger detail so you can see. You can see some white of drawing. There are colored grounds painted in succession. He blocks out different areas of color and then paints right into them. So the fact that there are no drawings is not actually uncommon for an artist like Vermeer or Caravaggio, if he's familiar to you. These artists worked in color directly on their canvases. And now that we have technical means of examining those, we can see the layers, we can see some drawing, we can see general areas of color, and they worked with successive layers of paint, some of them translucent, some of them opaque, working off of each other. So when you look at the surface of a Vermeer painting, you're looking at something that's multi-layered and that has its own opticality to it. So it wasn't clear to me how frequently Tim was working with anything but an opaque paint and sort of tracing motifs so the use of layers of paint is something that Vermeer is extraordinarily skilled at. These are four pictures. You can see him varying a theme. It's as if he's doing a kind of experiment, changing the lighting, but his subject is the same in all four cases. And in fact, all of these pictures were part of the same collection. They belong to a man who sort of bankrolled Vermeer's production, enabling him to kind of have this single-minded focus on a figure or two figures or three figures in the corner of a room. And as the conditions of lighting change, so do the things that are described by it. It's common, not just Tim and not just Penn, talk about, and this has been since the 19th century the case, talk about Vermeer's art as being very photographic or like some kind of optical medium. And they made mention, I think you'll remember, of video and television. And so they see this very much in terms of their own visual experience and iconosphere, you might call it. Well, of course, in Vermeer's time, it was impossible to see a photograph because they didn't exist. So when you saw optical images, that is to say, images made by the action of light, then what you saw were reflections and refractions and highlights and things in nature. And you saw things in lenses and also in the pre-photographic camera obscura. Tim is right when he says that Vermeer's paintings pop off the wall. They do. Especially the view of Delft, which is one of his largest pictures and one of the first big public perfectly known pictures in the 19th century when people were very much in tune with photography and its possibilities. But what Vermeer has done is to give us a rather traditional city view, that is to say, a profile of a town seen from across a river. You can find these all over the place in maps and also in paintings. And he shows it in this most extraordinary way, as if there's a passing shower and raindrops are pelting against this reflecting surface of the water and sort of diffusing and shattering in a way that image of the things reflected. So that natural image is now being naturally disturbed by this dense air and so forth. But when you look up close, as you see in this picture and the one I just showed you, these are details. Vermeer also made use of real materials. There's sand that's been added to the rooftop so that the little raised granules catch the real light in the room, and they sort of sparkle a little bit. They glisten. He also very emphatically shows us the artifice of his technique, right? We're not looking at bricks, we're looking at little dots and points of light as if the image has been somewhat disintegrated. We would think of pixelation in a way. And those effects that he emphasizes over and over again in his pictures are artifacts of the camera obscura. We know that these were in use for a long time. They were not primarily, in this moment, devices for making a picture. They were experimental demonstrations and things to be observed that showed you how nature makes images and how the eye itself made an image. So the camera obscura was seen as a demonstration, an analog, an experiment, something that made you experience and see for yourself how the eye could make an image. People were very, very fascinated in Vermeer's time by the capacity of a camera obscura to capture motion, life, in real time. And I'm showing you an upside down version of this so you can see that the preferred subjects were busy places, a promenade, a waterfront, some place where you could see life unfolding right before your eyes. They liked the cinematic quality of it. And Vermeer's image indeed fits the bill. It's the sort of picture that you would want to capture in a camera obscura. And I would say that he wants you to see this as an optically made image. That's the point. He's not hiding it at all. In fact, that would be true of these other pictures where he turns inward to the domestic space. And here I just give you two examples, one earlier and one later. You've seen the woman pouring milk, which is an extraordinary subject, by the way. Most of Vermeer's subjects are very conventional, and he does his own riff on them. But the woman pouring milk is really kind of unique. It's a strange subject, and it's one in which you're looking at this sort of endlessly pouring milk, right? He's trying to get some sense of temporality into it. And when you look up close, oh my God, there is this extraordinary play of these pointillé dots, right? They are absolutely independent of the description of bread. If you want to see bread, here's what a typical Dutch artist would do in a still life painting to show you the texture, the crust, and the little place where you pull the rolls apart. That's all shown in marvelous and suggestive descriptive detail. We are not seeing the description of bread in Vermeer. We are seeing some play of light. So it's the artifacts of the camera that he wants you to see. And there, too, in this very small, and I mean really tiny, picture of a woman making lace, you can see that you can only look at it by going up very close because it's so tiny. And when you go up close, you see these threads of paint that are just, you know, sort of oozing right out of her sewing cushion. And some parts are done with exquisite focus, right? That little knob here. That is just as crisp and as descriptively accurate as it could be. The face, on the other hand, is pretty strange. And it's been sort of almost looks like paint by numbers, right? There's a way in which the parts that you would expect an artist to put a great deal of human attention in have been made to look mechanical, even as these mechanical parts have been made to look rather, you know, as they would appear. So something's curiously amiss here. There is a way in which this kind of machine-like description that Tim is telling us about is being now focused on human life and human activity. There's an odd problem. That is a problem that's addressed in this picture, where the human dimension has been pushed way to the back wall there. And the composition, which was mentioned in the film, is very, very interesting indeed. There is a piling up, a sort of set of barricades, you might say, that separates the artist, the viewer, from this scene of a duet, a young man and a young woman at the virginals, presumably making music with all the connotations of that phrase. And so that's kind of interesting. The way Vermeer has painted it is also really interesting, and I can't go into all the details because they're really quite marvelous. One of the strange things that Vermeer does, which I don't think our friend Tim does, is he uses a very, very expensive pigment, ultramarine, as underpainting. Usually you kind of show that off because it's expensive and pricey, but he uses it as one of the ways that he gets that very cool light to emerge through the layers of other colors that are applied on top of it. And it's in there, in that floor. There's a lot of painting wet in wet, so layers of wet paint are stroked or streaked or dotted with wet paint for some of the details. Now, here's a place where I think you can see a clear difference, and that's in the red skirt, which we watched him paint. And the red is actually underpainting, and what's on top of that that makes the folds come through is another color, right? And that underpainting actually goes through, and he's painted the viola da gamba transparently over the underpainting to make it appear that the skirt is actually reflecting, right? The luminous quality that's attributed to Vermeer's pictures comes partly from moves like that, where things that are depicted seem to give off secondary and make secondary reflections in color on other objects, and that would be one place, and he doesn't do that much. He also, Vermeer, does not count every little thread. In fact, what you see is precisely not that. You see the overall impression that would be made by these points, and you have to fill in the blanks with Vermeer. He doesn't spell that all out for you. Extra shadow that you don't find in Tim's painting because it actually wouldn't be visible. There are invented elements that look very much as if they've been observed. And these diffuse contours and you know, shadows that spread out, these are also things that you could observe and depict without tracing them. You just observe them as phenomena and you find a formula for depicting them. So one of the things that was advised to artists using the camera obscura was to learn from the image, that is to say, look at it and you will see, according to Samuel von Hoogstraten, who wrote a book on painting and was a contemporary of Vermeer, you will see what a truly natural painting ought to look like. You'll see the modulation of tones, the way the edges work, right? Painters are very concerned with edges, how one thing bears on another. And the point was that that would be illuminating, that observing the way the optical image was made would help you as a painter to paint that way. Now, Vermeer paints in two different ways in this picture, and that was, I think, interestingly picked up by Tim, who says it's like a laboratory for him, this painting. And he's picking up on the differences between the way the paint is handled in these foreground objects and even on the virginal, and the way paint is handled in the mirror image that you see above the head of the woman. That mirror image is quite strange and interesting. It doesn't quite make clear its relation to the figure standing in front of it. There's a certain kind of disconnect. There's an ambiguity of how these three, the virtual image and these two, relate, this little triangle. And the way this is painted is like, it's like a map of tones placed one next to the other, very different from the more kind of crusty and clotted way that paint is applied elsewhere. So it's as if she's not looking at him, but she is looking at him. She looks at him in the mirror, but it's not clear from her posture that that's exactly what she's doing. And also, another detail that you might not have been aware of from Tim's picture is the easel, the foot of the artist's easel, which is not in the painting, by the way, is included in that mirror image. So something is going on there. The mirror is not just a transcriber of reality. It's an agent in and of itself. It's doing things. And if you think about Vermeer in relation to what I would say normal painters or the average good painter of his time does, they make an anecdote, they tell a story, they show a man and a woman easily interacting with one another. Vermeer, like, really does a number of things to mediate, distance the viewer from all that. And as Tim sort of makes that all very clear, they're looking at each other, that's reflected in the mirror, and he also shows the painting on the wall, which actually hung in Vermeer's house, belonged to his mother-in-law, of a story from ancient Rome of filial piety and Roman honor, in which a young woman gives suckle to her father, who has been imprisoned and sentenced to starve to death, and she's discovered, and she gets rewarded, and he gets liberated. It's all happy ending on the story. But for the moment, he's, you know, bound, right? Now, Vermeer does not show us anything but that, right? So he's made a very clear and allusion to just that bit. That's all filled in and made very explicit. So there's a kind of subtlety here. And I would say that what happens here in that mirror ends up becoming the painting itself in this one extraordinary picture, which everybody knows, that shows us the head of a young woman wearing a turban. And caught in a moment, right? It's an extraordinary picture that sort of captures a liminal moment in which you can't really say the gaze is moving toward you or away from you. It's a once-in-a-lifetime painting that he does. It's as if the camera obscura type image, that image made by light, becomes the painting itself and it looks back at you. And it's quite moving. But here's the last point I want to make. We've all seen photographs. We cannot erase the fact that we are photographic readers of images. There are a lot of ambiguities in this picture that we overlook because we're used to the photograph. So the optical ambiguities of this image speak to a kind of method of painting. That's what Vermeer gets from the camera obscura. He gets a way of painting that pretends not to bring what we know about a face to bear on the painting of it. And what I mean is, if you look at that nose, you cannot, by what the painting gives you, determine that there's a plane at the bridge of the nose, there's a plane here, there's a plane here. We know the three planes, but what Vermeer gives you is not, right? He just shows that tone, which is continuous overall. So the conceptual part of painting, what would normally be very carefully delineated through contours and cues, you fill in that information. It's not necessarily that you see it, but you know it and you put it there. And Vermeer leaves that out. You could compare even to Caravaggio, where it's less definite, but still the indications are given that allow you to see that cheekbone as separate. The extraordinary way in which, you know, paint is scumbled on to layers of paint, I'm not sure that you would ever see that in a camera obscura, but that is something that you learn to do as a painter. That pearl is definitely creating a secondary reflection, casting light of its own onto the collar and reflecting back. These sorts of plays are spectacular. The other thing he does is, with this optical method, he goes farther and farther and farther away from the describing of the things to just this kind of impartial mapping out of tone. And if you look at these pearls, I think you'll see what I mean. He hasn't actually drawn the contours of the pearls. You're filling that in on the basis of seeing just those little dots of paint, wet and wet. Here, Rembrandt gives you a contrast where he's actually sculpted them, given them relief in paint, and put this shadow underneath so that you perceive them as objects in and of themselves. This is just a band with dots, dot, 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 right? So where does Vermeer end up? Here. It's amazing. The naturalist idiom, which is the common way of painting in his time, is totally broken down to something that no longer has the integrity of a beautiful image. I mean, that face has become a mask, that string of pearls is just a string of dots of paint. So the moment that this picture represents was a singular one and a spectacular one. I doubt it would have been done without having looked at optical images, but I kind of don't think that they can explain it all. But we can talk about that. Thanks a lot.
You have some water back there?
I have to say, I'm just glad that Celeste said the most difficult part of this, and I think Tim might agree, was trying to stay in the pool of light as opposed to shortening lectures that they give at the university. I know each of you could have probably talked for an hour about this, and I think that these topics are, even independently but also combined, are so fascinating. So I really appreciate your brevity, because I know you could have, I think it's fascinating, and I'm so glad that you are both able to join us tonight. We do have time for some Q&A, and I have some lovely volunteers in the audience who are here to help me with that. So someone over on this side, we'll look around here to see if anybody has a question. Right in the middle. Yes, there's a young person with their hand raised. Right in the middle.
Well, I was looking online, this is a question about, like, optical images. I was looking online and I found something that if you put your finger between two boxes, the boxes would look the same, but when you didn't have your finger between it, they were different. It said that on the text on it. And well, so I'm just wondering, are they the same color or are they different colors?
Oh. Tim, what do you think?
Well, I have to see it, right?
Yeah.
You tell me. You mean here?
No.
Will you find us that website and we'll look at it after?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
that'll work.
I think it's about
We'll check it out. We will. We'll check it out and we'll get back to you in the lobby. Is that okay? Because we don't, without seeing the same thing that you saw, I don't know if we can.
I'll just say this. I'll bet you could figure it out.
Who else has a? Oh, Harvey, you've got. Do you have something?
No.
No questions.
We put you all to sleep.
No. It was just so thorough. It was good.
I got one.
Okay. Thanks, Harvey.
I need advice.
From both of you, but especially the art historian, to what extent do you think Vermeer did use technique like Tim was doing in here? You had mentioned a couple times possibly using camera obscura, for example, but yeah. I was wondering what do you think he went as far as was shown in the film?
I doubt it, but I do think that he probably, he definitely was interested in it and had access, and that he probably set up pictures, you know, and framed them, and maybe even, you know, watched those pictures while painting them as his source, right? So painting from an image as opposed to painting from, you know, directly from life. That's certainly a possibility. I think the tracing part of it is a little bit, it's a little bit unconvincing because that's not what the pictures look like for the most part. I mean, they really don't. And so if tracing happened, then he felt it, you know, incumbent upon him to make it look different than that. But I think he was all about advertising the optical qualities and the artificiality of that as something wonderful and not hiding it. I think, you know, I think David Hockney is, you know, imagining that artists had to keep this a secret. In Vermeer's world, you wouldn't keep it a secret. You'd let it out and I think you'd show it.
So, just to the point of whether he used that very specific instrument of the mirror, which may be part of your question, there's no way to know historically. However, actually, I did make one picture here to show you one thing, just to reassure you about Tim. I call it the device check. And here he is. This is one of the scenes from the movie. And what we expect is, I just had to add some more physics for you, is that the light hitting the mirror that came from a spot on the picture of his father-in-law would reflect off the mirror, obeying the law of reflection, which is pretty straightforward, so that the angles are equal as you see them here. At the same time, so that means that the light comes up to his eye, and at the same time, you can see that his eye can look past the edge of the mirror where I've made the intersection and right down to the part of this. So this is plausible, right? So, you know, it's even plausible that Tim Jameson really did this. So that was my first reason that I checked this. That what I think makes me wonder, though, is if the purpose of this device was to match colors, the colors on even on the subject here, which may have been the screen of a camera obscura or not, whatever it is, the colors there are not necessarily the color here because they have different lighting on them. And so it looks different to us. And of course, the paint dries. So it's really hard to imagine that even, you know, this wonderful technical device would have been as useful for that very specific purpose. But, you know, my job is to be skeptical, so.
We're going to come right down here over on the yeah. All right.
Back to the movie. In the 1940s, there was this famous, or better, infamous forger, Han van Meegeren, or van Meegeren, if you prefer.
Yes.
And he duped all the experts, Rotterdam Museum, and he made a lot of money, Hermann Göring, which finally took him in. And I wonder, how is this ever possible? And he certainly didn't use any of these optical techniques.
No.
How was this ever possible? I mean, in hindsight, of course, we say this was not a Vermeer, but a van Meegeren. How was this possible?
This is a great question. And, you know, if you can see those paintings, a number of them now in Rotterdam, and you look at them and you say, how could anybody ever think these were Vermeers? But the reasons that people did was not because they looked like Vermeer. It was because they were hoping to find the missing link between Vermeer's early work and his later work. So van Meegeren very cleverly, you know, came up with these religious pictures that, you know, sort of had a little of this and a little of that. I mean, it was the desire for, you know, lost Vermeers that made people believe them, even experts, more than their actual, you know, similarity to Vermeer's pictures, and certainly not to his way of painting. And what I didn't go into great detail about it, but one of the things that is so characteristic of Vermeer is this optical method that is not conceptual. And so when people start filling in what we know about faces, I know it's not Vermeer, because that's not the way he works up the figures. I mean, it's just, it's a mode of rendering, it's a mode of, you know, resisting that kind of conceptual clarity. He just doesn't do it. And so when somebody imitates him and does it, and then you say, no, probably not. So, yeah. But it is a great, I mean, there's a wonderful film about it, which you may, I think it's online at the website of the Boijmans Museum, where they go through the whole, with some great documentary footage of van Meegeren and the whole thing. I mean, it was just outrageous.
Harvey has a question back there in the back.
Hi. In the movie, Tim's technique, I noticed, was painted, he painted horizontally on a flat surface. And I mean, I'm an art student, and most painters that I know usually paint on easels. And you pointed out that the leg of the easel is visible in Vermeer's original painting. And I was just wondering what you thought about that.
Yeah, well, I think the whole point of Tim's device is to allow you to have, you know, in a single view, your subject and your working surface, right? And of course, if you have a vertical or nearly vertical easel and a subject in front of you, I mean, that makes a lot more sense, right? But if you're working on a flat surface, then what he's doing, you know, helps you to move from your subject to your drawing or your painting. So it's, you know, it's a question, but I think most painters in Vermeer's time did work on easels when they did oil painting. But you know, we don't know for a fact. So my imagination of Vermeer working is Vermeer working like this and not like this.
Yeah. Over here?
Yes, Celeste, earlier in your talk you suggested, and I might be interpolating what you were saying, but suggested that Tim was thinking in two dimensions rather than three dimensions as a normal painter would with layers. And I'm wondering whether this technique could have been used by an experienced painter and still allow them to paint in layers.
Yeah. Oh, I think so. Yeah. I mean, look, I don't think it's impossible, but I just think that the way it would have been used by an experienced painter would have been quite different. I mean, let's say with, you know, let's just hypothesized that such a device existed. I think if a trained painter used it, he or she would do something quite different from what Tim does, because you would want to get, you know, maybe certain passages, certain things, but I can't see that as a way of working. It doesn't pay much, and it doesn't allow for the kind of, effects, I think, that people really looked for in pictures at the time. I mean, I don't start from the assumption that what people want is a transcription of reality. Painting doesn't do that, and why would you want that? You want a painting. You don't want, you know, a photograph, and a photograph isn't a transcription of reality either. So it's the, I guess what I'm saying is that the process of translation is interesting to me, and I think that a painter translates through a variety of notations and conventions that you learn and that we learn to read as representing things in a particular way. And I don't think you would willingly give all that up, though Vermeer plays with that. I mean, he does play with this issue. So I think, anyway, I don't know if that answers your question, but.
I liked it.
Yeah.
Oh, hold on just a sec. We're bringing you. We're bringing you a microphone.
Oh, is that Jim? Oh,
is that Jim?
Jim.
Tim wasn't painting from reality. He was painting a Vermeer.
Yeah. Well, no, and he was painting a model of mock-up.
Right, so there's an interesting kind of bouncing back and forth. He was painting at a representation of a Vermeer painting.
Right.
Which is to say that Vermeer had already done a whole lot of work for him.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say that's true.
And that a lot of the marvel of the Vermeer painting had already been accomplished before Tim ever sat down with his brush,
yeah,
in the shapes and relationships that then Tim worked very hard to set up. Another thing that occurs to me is that this isn't, help me out here, I don't think it's tracing, it's adjacency,
right,
comparison, sliding,
right,
back and forth, right.
Right? Right, it's matching.
It's matching.
Yeah.
So our young man, or whoever spoke a few minutes ago about distance,
yeah,
his observation about how things change when things are adjacent,
yeah,
or apart becomes really critical in, yeah, the process, yeah, that Tim is carrying out. What he's doing is bringing them next to each other,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and then making it mobile,
mm-hmm,
so that he can see multiple relationships in a close period of time,
mm-hmm,
where training would allow you to do that without the immediate adjacency.
Absolutely.
Which,
yeah,
kind of answers to the question of how necessary,
yeah,
is all of this apparatus.
Right. I think, though, the important point that you, I'm glad you brought it up, is that both Vermeer and Tim are ostensibly painting from an image. And so that mediation, that optical mediation, is part of what Vermeer is about. And that is, in a way, it's like doubling what the eye does. If you imagine that the eye is making a picture, and that this picture out there is a kind of picture like the picture made in the eye, it's sort of, on the one hand, it's turning your subject into a picture before you even start to picture it. And I think that's really important. And maybe that's where, you know, Hockney and others and people who today, you know, paint from photography, you're really painting from an optically mediated image, and that's what you're working with. So I think that's something they have in common. Although, I'll just leave it at that. But.
I'm going to come all the way to the back here. Thanks, Ron.
If there are primary colors of red and yellow and blue, why do we have cones in our eyes that see red and green and blue?
So I believe the artists in the audience can help me here, but we have red, green, and blue are the way our eyes work. And when light is projected so that we detect it with our eyes, the projectors actually use red, green, and blue. But printer's inks, which work differently, light reflects off the printed page, off a printed picture, and so on. And so essentially, there's the inverse set, the set that I showed you, which are yellow, magenta, and cyan, so sometimes called printer's colors. And so if you take one of the primary additive colors away, you get the printer's colors, each of those three. Does that answer your question? So one is a set of additive colors, red, green, and blue. One is a set of subtractive colors that work on reflected things that are on a printed page, cyan, magenta, and yellow.
That helped.
I had a comment.
Thank you. Oh, yes, right over here. And only have time for one or two more, so questions would be great.
Yeah, I'm an artist and a painter, and I teach a lot of perspective at College of Creative Studies. To me, it's actually what you said about Vermeer massing in with paint and then painting into the paint with his drawing. He's not actually using a drawing, he's massing. To me, he was actually ahead of his time in that he was, to me, it looked like those soft faces are from squinting, which 18th, 19th, and mostly a lot of 19th and 20th century painters did. Instead of trying to get every detail, I think what you're saying is instead of ruining the beauty of the simpler shapes and the more beautiful form and softer edges, he's not trying to describe all the rendering like his contemporaries. To me, it seemed like he had his own new concept of how to paint form. And instead of maybe having to have a device, he simply saw it differently in his mind and invented a way of seeing that no one else was doing at that point. I mean, I can't prove that any more than you can prove it was a camera obscura, but right. To me, it looks like he was doing the opposite. He was squinting and being more of a generalist and massing, you know, paint yeah. together and more softly than his contemporaries. Like you said with the pearls, he was just catching the highlights so that you would just imply the rest of them, whereas all his contemporaries had to do like five different values to render them perfectly. Yeah. So to me, he's almost like a rebel in the opposite, and he's more of an impressionist at that point than anybody at the time. That would be my read on it.
But. Yeah, I think that's the real challenge of Vermeer, is to kind of situate him historically, because you know, it's easy for us to look back and see through the lens of impressionism, post-impressionism, all of the, you know, photography, all the things that are part of our visual universe that were not part of his. And so it's trying to understand what he's doing there in their terms a little bit. Like, why would anybody want pictures that look like his pictures? And it's clear that, you know, one person owned 20 plus of his paintings, of which there were never more than, we think, about 40, and we have 35 or however you count them extant, right? So it's a very small oeuvre, and it's very single-minded, and he kind of works through a long time ago, in the 1950s, a painter art historian named Lawrence Gowing wrote a wonderful book on Vermeer, in which he sort of said, you know, the thing about Vermeer that's so interesting and so defining is that he used the camera obscura not in the service of accuracy or reality, but in the service of style. He created a way of painting that emulated the artifice, the artifacts of this device, the circles of halation, the, you know, blurred contours, all kinds of things that you could see there. And I think my personal feeling is that he's referencing them. He wants you to see his image as if it's optically made, and as if, you know, he's doing that. Now, why would that be interesting? Well, at that moment, this device is a model of vision, and it's being defined as a model of painting, a model of truly natural painting. If you want to see what a natural painting looks like, look in the camera obscura and learn from it. So I think he's kind of playing it out in their terms, but I totally agree that it anticipates a whole lot of stuff that will become part of, you know, pictorial practice later on. Interesting.
We have one more right here in the middle.
You already kind of answered it, but just to make it clear, you mentioned how Vermeer purposefully included these aberrations due to the camera obscura. Was he the only painter who did that, or did anyone else do that on purpose?
Great question. There are a couple, Willem Kalf would be another artist that I would suggest you look at to see, but it's different. It's not the same as Vermeer. I don't, honestly, there is no one who paints like Vermeer in the 17th century that I know of. Now, if there is, I'll be very, very interested to know, but I haven't found it. And nobody talks about it at the time either. So all of the talk we have about Vermeer is modern. And that's where it gets interesting, right? Because that's where we are.
I just love this. Thank you. Thank you both so much for coming. And thank you all for sticking around for Q&A.